All right, so we left off on the slide before this. So we did a review of the action potential and multiplicative sodium and multiplicative potassium channels. So what we are going to do today is talk about the specific multiplicative sodium and to a very small extent potassium channels that are found in nociceptors and a little bit about what they do, so their basic physiology. But more importantly, to talk about them as drug targets and how we know that they're drug targets, okay? So the basic concept of the lecture today is on multiplicative sodium channels, okay? But what I really want you guys to take away from this lecture is some of the logic behind how you would decide that something is a target for a disease, okay? So we're gonna use this example of multiplicative sodium channels and nociceptors to kind of work through that. There's a couple of different layers to that. One of the layers is the physiology, right? So what role do these channels play in the physiology of these cells, number one. Number two, do they have any specificity? So could you target them and have a relatively small number of side effects, okay? And number three, do you have some reason from the clinic or something to think that they play a role in disease? So one way that we commonly go about doing this is to use genetics. And for these particular things, we have three really good stories to tell about those three ideas that I just mentioned to you, right? So number one, we know, and this is what we'll start with, we know a lot about the physiology of these multiplicative sodium channels in particular, in dorsal root ganglion neurons and what they do. And basically what they do is they allow these neurons to be able to conduct, to generate an action potential and then conduct that action potential to the brain. Pretty important function for these neurons. You could argue that's their most essential function, right? All right, number two, we know really a lot actually about their specificity. So I won't give that part of the story away right now. That'll be what we talk about in the coming slides. And then number three, the genetics are really fascinating. Okay, so we're gonna focus on those three issues, mainly the latter two issues. Then we'll talk briefly about multiplicative potassium channels, and the reason that we won't talk so long about those is we just don't know as much about them as we do about the multiplicative sodium channels, but the story that's emerging about multiplicative potassium channels is really interesting. And then we're gonna wrap up with just a clinical interlude, I guess, about why targeting the activity of nociceptors is very likely to work for most chronic pain patients. Maybe not every single chronic pain patient, but most of them, okay? Upwards of 90-95%. I would argue. There are people, however, if they were given the same class, would probably not agree with me, okay? So keep that in mind, but I'm the teacher. All right. So this is the cartoon version of a peripheral neuron. The actual peripheral neuron looks something more like this, the cell body, which we spend a lot of time talking about, and I showed you lots of images of. It's just a tiny little thing that's found in the dorsal root ganglion. These cells are almost entirely axon, right? And that axon is really important because the axon has to have a message go along it, and that message is an action potential, right? So from the peripheral end on to the central end, you have to be able to, number one, transduce a signal, right? So you need some kind of way to turn a chemical or some other type of signal into an electrical signal, and then you have to conduct that all the way along this thing. Remember, for most of the nociceptors, which are C fibers, they are not myelinated. So that's actually a pretty big job, right? If you put myelin onto axons, you don't need as many multiplicated sodium channels because you have this nice thing that we call saltatory conduction, right? Where the potential kind of just slides along this place that has a really good insulator on it. These cells don't have a very good insulator, so they need a lot of voltage-gated sodium channel. Sorry, your hand was up.
Oh, no, I just noticed that that little bank of them, those little strands just piled on top of each other.
Yeah, that's what it is, sorry, yeah. So it's just going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, okay? So, you know, if this is a dorsal root ganglion neuron that's found in your L4 DRG, which is somewhere in here, right, and is innervating your leg, that is an axon for probably almost everybody in this room is close to a meter long, right? So that's a long way to conduct an electrical signal. And then once you pass the cell body, there's still a ways to go because of the way that the spinal cord is arranged. We'll talk about this in the second part of the course. You know, central extension actually needs to go up quite a ways in your spinal column before it actually gets to the dorsal horn where it connects to the central nervous system through its first synapse in the dorsal horn, right? So there's a whole lot of axon there, and you have to conduct that potential along that entire axon. So how do these cells do that? They do it with voltage-gated sodium channels, of course. The thing that is interesting about these cells is that they don't express the same voltage-gated sodium channels that are found in many parts of the brain. Now, to some extent, they have some of these same voltage-gated sodium channels, but especially for the C fibers, they seem to primarily use two voltage-gated sodium channels, NAD1.8 and NAD1.7, that are relatively specifically expressed in the peripheral nervous system. So, and for NAD1.8, the specificity is actually remarkably specific. Okay, so NAD1.8 is essentially not found in any other cells in your body except the dorsal root ganglion and trigeminal ganglion neurons that we classify as C fibers. Okay, and almost all of them express it. Okay, it's actually a very interesting story about how these were discovered. There's a guy that I actually know very well because I sat next to him for 3 years when I was doing my PhD. He was a research professor in Ken Hargreaves' lab where I did my PhD. And this is not when he discovered NAD1.8, but Armin Akopian is his name. If you go look up the NAD1.8 papers, he's the first author on the paper that was published in Nature that described this. And he used a really pretty ingenious method to find genes that were specifically expressed in nociceptors. What he did was he took all of the RNA that was expressed in DRG neurons, and then he took all of the RNA that was expressed in the kidney, and he used a subtractive method to basically find all the genes that were found in the DRG, but not in the kidney. So it was one of the first examples of what we call subtractive cloning. And what that allowed Armin to do when he was still in the Soviet Union, actually, he's Russian, was to find a bunch of genes that were relatively specifically expressed in the dorsal root ganglion. And what he was looking for were some specific voltage-gated sodium and also receptors that are found in the DRG. So one question you could ask is, how did he know that there were voltage-gated sodium channels that were found specifically in the dorsal root ganglion and probably not in the brain? And the reason that he knew that is a very simple one, and it goes to pharmacology. So you guys may remember from cellular neuroscience, or you may have already taken neuropharmacology, that there's a very commonly used voltage-gated sodium channel blocker that comes from pufferfish that's called tetrodotoxin. Has everybody heard of this before? Yeah, okay, right? So tetrodotoxin is an extraordinarily potent toxin that this pufferfish uses to basically kill things that might come after it, right? So if a fish, or a human for that matter, punctures the liver of this pufferfish where it has the TTX, it paralyzes it and will likely kill it because it blocks the activity of motor neurons as well as most central neurons. So what physiologists working on the dorsal root ganglion noticed a decade or more before Armin was doing these subtractive experiments was something pretty interesting. And that was that you can't actually block the most of the voltage-gated sodium channels that are found in nociceptors with tetrodotoxin. So this led to the classification of two types of voltage-gated sodium channels. the tetrodotoxin sensitive voltage gated sodium channels and the tetrodotoxin insensitive voltage gated sodium channels. And it turns out that just about the only place that you find tetrodotoxin insensitive voltage gated sodium channels is in nociceptors in the dorsal root ganglia. So for many decades, people were trying to figure out what on earth this gene was, because people knew that it would probably make a really good drug target. All right, so why would it make a good drug target? Well, the reason it would make a good drug target is because, again, if you look in other nervous system tissues, including the entire brain, you see very, very little tetrodotoxin insensitive voltage gated sodium channels. And the only place you see it is in the dorsal root ganglia. So if you wanted to make a pain drug, what would you want to know? Well, you would want to know what on earth is that tetrodotoxin insensitive voltage gated sodium channel, so you could then make a specific drug that would actually block it, right? So I'd love to be able to tell you that, yeah, Armin discovered this thing, which we now call NAD1.8, although we now know that there's multiple TTX-resistant voltage-gated sodium channels. So there's two really good examples of them that are found in the DRD in adults, NAD1.8 and NAD1.9. You may have never heard of NAD1.9 before, but we'll talk about that today. So these things are likely to make pretty good targets for pain, because you could block those particular neurons, the pain-sensing neurons, and not affect the entire rest of the brain, right? If you take something like lidocaine, right, that blocks voltage-gated sodium channels when you have it injected to have a dental procedure, if you take enough of that that it gets into your brain, what does it do? You get what's called bilateral death. It kills you, right? So nobody laughs at that joke until they've had neuroanatomy. So if you take enough lidocaine, it will block all of your voltage-gated sodium channels. So lidocaine is very good at blocking pain, right? I mean, anybody that goes to the dentist is happy that we have lidocaine. However, you can't use it as a drug that would specifically target the peripheral nervous system. If you have enough of it in your blood, it stops your heart. But these things could potentially make really good drugs. So, you know, that's something we'll continue to talk about throughout the lecture today, and in fact throughout the class, okay? Because it's a principle that's very useful. One of the amazing things about what Armin did is he essentially discovered all of the channels that are specifically expressed in dorsal root ganglia. So, you know, there's one single person discovered NAD1.8, P2X3, which we'll talk about later in the class, the acid sensing ion channels that are specific for the dorsal root ganglia, which we'll also talk about later in the class. So, you know, it's really a remarkable discovery that he made. He made that discovery, by the way, at first in the Soviet Union, and then he went to London and worked with a guy named John Wood, who we'll talk a lot about in this class too, because he's one of the best known scientists working in the pain field. So he's still very active in it at University College London. Okay, so these neurons have transducers, which we'll start talking about next week, that are found in their peripheral terminals that allow them to detect tissue damage, temperature, acid, all kinds of things, right? And they also have voltage-gated sodium channels that are found at their endings to help generate generator potentials, okay? So we have voltage-gated sodium channels that have a pretty low threshold for opening, so they can amplify depolarization. And then we have other voltage-gated sodium channels that essentially line the entire length of the axon, and those include NAD1.8 and NAD1.7 in nociceptors to propagate the action potential. You also see NAD1.6, which is found throughout the brain as well. So not all of the voltage-gated sodium channels in nociceptors are exclusive to nociceptors. Some of them are also found very abundantly in the CNS. NAD1.6 is a really good example of that. And then there's potassium channels along these things, and then lying from one end in the periphery all the way into the central nervous system, because the action potential has to go that entire distance to then lead to the activation of voltage-gated calcium channels that are found presynaptically to induce neurotransmitter release, which for most of these neurons, the neurotransmitter, the primary neurotransmitter is glutamate, and of course some of them also release these neuropeptides like CGRP and substance P, which we call the peptidergic class of nociceptors. And then that acts on second order neurons. So we'll talk about that transduction mechanism in the CNS in the second part of the course. Okay, so just to remind you that we already have lots of drugs that we use clinically that block voltage-gated sodium channels. These drugs are often referred to as local anesthetics, and almost all of them in cane, okay? So here's a list of them. Lidocaine is the most common one, but there are ones that have longer or shorter half-lives. So lidocaine is often used as a local anesthetic in dentist's office. Sometimes people will use bupivacaine because it has a longer duration of action. Essentially, it just has a longer half-life. So when you inject it, it sticks around longer before it gets metabolized, so it leads to an anesthetic action that lasts for a longer period. Cocaine, before it became a popular recreational drug, was used as a local anesthetic, so it was what dentists had, as well as surgeons, right, before lidocaine and bupivacaine and things like that were developed. So, you know, sometimes you see in movies people rub the cocaine on their lip or something like that to see if it's real. Well, the way that they know it's real is because their lip gets numb, okay? Because it's a local anesthetic, makes your lip get numb. So then we have these other ones that are here. These drugs have few side effects when they're used clinically, but they can have amazingly detrimental side effects if you take them at too large doses. And that is just simply because they block all voltage-gated sodium channels. They have no selectivity for one type of voltage-gated channel over another. So if you get enough of them in your bloodstream, they will stop your heart. If you get enough of them in your brain will stop functioning. Neither of those things are compatible with life, right? So you have to be careful when these drugs are used. The other problem with them, well, there's two other major problems with them. One is that while you can go to the dentist and get an injection of lidocaine, you can't go to the dentist every day and get an injection of lidocaine because nobody wants to see their dentist that often. You can't do that because you guys are gradually getting used to my jokes. You can't do it because if you get an injection of lidocaine every day, it has a neurotoxic effect. Okay, so having a like permanent nerve block can cause a nerve lesion, and that can result in neuropathic pain, right? So it's not something that you can do with these drugs. So that's one limitation. The other big limitation is while they may block sensory input that you don't want to have, like when you're at the dentist's office, they also block motor function. So, you know, you can't feel your mouth, but you also can't keep your saliva in your mouth, and you can't talk very well, right? And nobody wants to do that all the time either. So, you know, if you have neuropathic pain in your leg and you can't bear the pain anymore, it may be worth it to you for some period of time to have a nerve block where you can't move your leg, but you probably wouldn't tolerate that all the time, right? You want to be able to move your leg. It's a reasonable expectation. So the hope is that we can eventually develop drugs that are like these things, but that they're very specific. Okay, and the concept is that the opportunity is to develop drugs that can block NaV1.8, NaV1.7, or NaV1.9, and that those could be these kind of drugs that would only block the sensory input, the painful sensory input, but leave everything intact, everything else intact. You would have light touch sensation, proprioception, the ability to use motor function, have very little problem with side effect liability because you don't have these channels in your heart, for instance. You mostly don't have them in your brain. So it's a good opportunity. The problem is that all voltage-gated sodium channels, and there's 10 of these genes, right? They all have the same topology, and their amino acid sequences are very similar to one another. So it's actually very hard to make a drug that will recognize one of them and not another one. So academics like me and drug companies like Pfizer, Merck, etc. have been working on this problem now for a long time. Armin discovered or cloned NaV1.8 in the late 90s. So, you know, it's been out there for about 20 years now. for people to work on in the public and private spheres. And we still don't have a NaV1.8 inhibitor that's gone into wide clinical use. There are many companies that are in either clinical development or actually in clinical trials of NaV1.8 inhibitors. So, you know, for a lot of you, it seemed like almost everybody raised their hand with their interest in some kind of healthcare career. It's possible that by the time you get out there, that drugs that target these channels, it might be NaV1.8, it might be NaV1.7, might also be NaV1.9, will be widely used. And I would anticipate if they actually make it out there, they'll have a transformative effect on the treatment of pain. The problem is it's a really tough problem to make drugs that will specifically target those channels. Okay. All right, so again, these voltage-gated channels are found all along these axons. So what are the specific ones that are found in the dorsal root ganglion or the trigeminal ganglion? So this is a list that was put together by two luminaries in the voltage-gated channel field in pain, and also in the pharmaceutical development of compounds that act on these channels, Steve Waxman and Gerald Zamponi. So Steve Waxman is at Yale, Gerald Zamponi is at University of Calgary. This review, which I posted in your additional reading materials, is terrific. If you're at least mildly interested in pharmaceutical development for pain, this is a terrific one to read because they do a fantastic job of really clearly laying out the case for what all these targets are and why they're either good or not in their highly informed opinion. And also give you a good idea of where we stand in terms of their development. And this review was published pretty recently, so it gives you a really nice comprehensive picture of lots of different areas. We don't have time to go through all the targets in detail, so what we're going to do today is we're going to focus primarily on these four voltage-gated sodium channels. Okay, so what I'm going to do for the next like 30 minutes or so is to kind of tell you the story about why each one of these is important and give you some view on kind of where we stand in terms of their development. All right, so we'll make the case and then we'll conclude with where we stand. We've already talked a lot about NaV1.8, so we won't spend so much time on that one. Okay, so here they are again, so you can actually see this, and here's some of the detail of why they're relevant. So let's go through that in a little bit more detail. So first of all, this shows you a little bit more about the rationale, where they're expressed, some of their physiological attributes, also whether or not they're blocked by tetrodotoxin. So you can see that NaV1.3 and NaV1.7 are blocked very potently by tetrodotoxin, right? One nanomolar-ish TTX blocks these channels almost completely. But look at this. NaV1.8 and NaV1.9, the KD is 40 micromolar. So, you know, it's 10,000 times to the right in terms of the concentration needed to block these versus the other. That's why we call these channels tetrodotoxin sensitive and these channels tetrodotoxin insensitive. Okay? Hang on, yeah.
So TTX blocks NaV1.7 but leaves NaV1.8 and 1.9. But the mutation in SCN9A, like we talked about this class 2 weeks ago, that blocks NaV1.7 and leaves NaV1.8 and 1.9. So how come we can't feel pain with that, but we can with injections of TTX?
Alright, so the question is, why is it when you have a loss of function NaV1.7 mutation, which is blocked by TTX, do you have a total loss of pain, but TTX injections can also block pain, right? So maybe that was the answer to your question, actually. So both of those seem to be able to work, right? So action potential generation and action potential propagation in DRG neurons both seem to rely on NaV1.7 and NaV1.8. I think we now know that there are some mutations in NAV 1.8 that lead to loss of function where people don't feel pain at all. It's just not as well described as NAV 1.7. We also know that for NAV 1.9, actually. So there are some congenital insensitivity to pain phenotypes from NAV 1.9 mutations. So it seems to be all three of these are kind of required. Does that answer the question?
Yeah.
Okay. It does. So I mean, people are actually, so there's a company that is developing TTX as a local pain therapeutic. And the concept there is that it you know, you can use a relatively small concentration that's not dangerous locally, and that it doesn't have as strong of an effect on motor function, but still blocks sensory function and works pretty well. And the idea is that it blocks mostly NAV 1.7. So whether or not they're going to be successful with that approach sounds a little risky to me. We'll see. Okay. All right, so let's go through these one by one then. All right, so first of all, where are they expressed? So this is showing you the major voltage-gated sodium channels that are found in the nervous system. So that the brain and the peripheral nervous system. And in blue, we're looking at neurofilament 200. So this is a specific marker. If you remember back to that slide where I talked about all these markers for these neurons, neurofilament 200 is a specific marker for large diameter neurons, so mostly A-beta fibers. Okay. So all these large-looking neurons here, those are the A-beta fibers. And then in green, we have perforin. Right? And perforin is a marker for small diameter unmyelinated neurons, so it labels the C fibers. So first of all, if you look at this picture, which is for NAV 1.1 expression, you'll note, and the voltage-gated sodium channel stuff is all in red. There's basically no red here, right? There's a little bit, but not very much. So the blue population and the green population are non-overlapping, and the blue cells are obviously bigger than the green cells, right? Can we all agree on that? Okay, good. So this is a really nice way, if you want to see what population these channels are found in, to figure it out, okay? So NAV 1.1, NAV 1.2, and NAV 1.3, and NAV 1.5 are mostly not expressed in the adult dorsal root ganglion. I'm going to talk to you about why NAV 1.3 might be an interesting pain target. So I'll explain why, even though it's not expressed here in the coming slides. Okay, but keep in mind that in the normal adult DRG, NAV 1.3 is not expressed. Right? NAV 1.6 is expressed in most, if not all, DRG neurons. NAV 1.7 also appears to be in most, if not all, DRG neurons. Maybe some large diameter neurons don't express it. The small diameter ones certainly do. And it's found in almost all of them. NAV 1.8, as you can hopefully appreciate, is pretty specific. You mostly do not find it in the large diameter neurons, and it's mostly found in the small diameter neurons. Okay, so this one also, if you looked in the brain or any other tissue in the body, you will not find its expression. It's extraordinarily specific for the DRG and trigeminal ganglion. And then NAV 1.9 is also pretty specifically expressed in nociceptors. Okay. So we really have, at least in the adult normal animal, we have three pretty good, fairly specific targets. That's NAV 1.7, NAV 1.8, and NAV 1.9. All right, so what is the deal with NAV 1.3? I'm actually going to talk about this as we go. So you should familiarize yourself with this slide, but I'm going to talk about it for each individual channel. Okay? All right, so what is the story with NAV 1.3? So NAV 1.3 was discovered very early on in neuroscience because it plays an important role in the development of the nervous system. So this is a voltage-gated sodium channel that is expressed in most of the nervous system during early embryonic development, and then expression of the gene shuts off. So that happens in the brain and the dorsal root ganglion. Okay, so you can see here, this is an embryonic dorsal root ganglion. The black signal is mRNA for NAV 1.3. So there's lots of expression of NAV 1.3. But this is mRNA. The previous slide was protein. Okay. So protein, there's no expression in the adult. If you look at mRNA, there's also no expression. Okay. So NAV 1.3 is only really expressed in the nervous system, peripheral and central nervous system, in early development. Something very interesting happens, though, if you have an injury to the nervous system. Okay? If you have an injury to the nervous system, NaV1.3 expression turns back on. All right? So because NaV1.3 produces very large ramp currents and a persistent sodium current, there's this idea that this injury-induced expression of NaV1.3 could make this a very important target for people, for instance, that have neuropathic pain. All right? So this was actually one of the relatively early discoveries in kind of the molecular biology of neuropathic pain. This was made before I was even a graduate student in the early 2000s. So this is also part of a whole number of studies that have demonstrated something that I think is really pretty interesting, and we now know this happens in the brain as well, is that many genes that are expressed during early development and then shut off once the brain matures can be turned back on by an injury to the nervous system. And they seem to play a role in development, but they also play a role in pathology if they're turned back on in the adult nervous system. Okay? So for this particular example, the idea is that you could relatively specifically target injured nerves and increase excitability in injured nerves by targeting NaV1.3. So what happened to that target? Well, people are still working on it, but one of the things that has been confusing in the field is that many people have made knockouts, so mice that completely lack these genes, and found that they don't have very strong neuropathic pain phenotypes. What other people have done is to use pharmacological or knockdown technologies to manipulate these genes, and they sometimes find that they do have very strong phenotypes. And there's been a lot of confusion about whether the knockout is right or the knockdown or pharmacological approach is right. And it's hard to determine from a development standpoint what you should do. So I think that that is a problem that still exists, and nobody knows exactly how to solve it. Not next week, but the week after, we're going to talk in more detail about these kind of knockout effects, how we make knockouts, how we use them in the pain literature, but also some of these controversies and paradoxes that have emerged from that. So that slide I showed you before shows you differences in knockout phenotypes versus antisense or pharmacological effects. And NaV1.3 is a good example where the knockout doesn't have much phenotype, but the pharmacology and knockdown has supported its potential role. So we still don't have an answer to that. It may turn out that NaV1.3 is actually a very good neuropathic pain target. We just don't know. Okay. NaV1.7 is kind of the king right now. All right. So in terms of effort to develop a drug that can be a solution for an acute pain and also a chronic pain medicine, I would argue that right now, NaV1.7 is the hottest target out there. There's lots of companies that are working on it, lots of academics that are working on it, and there are a number of molecules that are in clinical trials. So this one is getting its day in court, basically, right now, and we're going to see what happens. Right? And right now, it's all rumor, because the clinical trials are still going on, so nobody actually really knows what the results are going to be. So the interest in NaV1.7 really started with genetics. Okay, so we already talked about the gain of function and loss of function. So I'm not going to go into a lot of detail again on that today, other than to say that was really the eureka moment for this particular target that got lots of people interested in it. And as the genetic evidence has continued to accumulate, it is spread throughout the voltage-gated sodium channel field. So all of these findings on the loss of function causing a lack of pain sensitivity and the gain of function causing these intractable pain disorders caused these pain geneticists to then go look at other voltage-gated sodium channels like NaV1.8 and NaV1.9. And lo and behold, they found results that are very similar, right? So it appears, generally speaking, that gain of functions in these nociceptor-specific channels cause maybe pain without injury, or they increase your susceptibility to develop pain if you have an injury, and loss of function leads to a lack of pain sensation altogether. What NaV1.7 does is it produces very large ramp currents. So what is it? I told you NaV1.3 does that as well, but I don't think I explained what that actually means. What it means is if you give a cell a slow depolarization, these particular channels really like that kind of stimulus. Okay, so you can imagine what that means. If you're a nociceptor and you're a nociceptor ending, and there's a little bit of inflammation, there's some PGE2 hanging around, it's giving you a mild depolarization. If you have a lot of these channels that like that depolarization, they're going to amplify that depolarization pretty dramatically. Okay, so these types of channels are really good detectors of those, and they cause these neurons to fire repetitive action potentials in response to that. So essentially what they do is they can amplify small depolarizations that allow these neurons to fire a whole, like a train of action potentials. And as we already talked about, these cause, these gain of function mutations cause these intractable pain phenotypes like erythromyalgia, as shown here in this slide. And there, we've now discovered a whole bunch of different mutations, some of which are gain of function, some of which are loss of functions, but let's show you what it means to the physiology. So this is a electrophysiology experiment in either cells expressing a wild type in NaV1.7, so a NaV1.7 that doesn't have a mutation, or a NaV1.7 mutation that is known to cause gain of function and intractable pain in the people that have this mutation. Okay, so the left is the normal channel, the right is the mutant channel. So what you can see is if you apply a small depolarization to either the wild type or the mutant channel, that you need less current injection to get action potentials from the wild type channel. Okay. So basically from the mutant channel. So basically what happens is this point mutation causes the voltage-gated sodium channel to be more sensitive to small depolarizations. Okay. So it's shifting the stimulus response curve, the stimulus being depolarization, to the left. Okay. So it makes it easier for the neurons to fire an action potential. It's increasing their excitability. Right. So that's what you see here. The other thing is it increases the number of action potentials that the neuron will fire. All right. So to a ramp depolarization, this wild-type neuron will fire 2 action potentials, whereas the one with the mutation fires 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 action potentials. Right. So a really dramatic change in the excitability based on that single-point mutation. And you can show this for almost all of those point mutations that cause these intractable pain disorders. So it increases the excitability. What's really interesting about these channels is that you can make them look like they have a mutation by inducing a post-translational modification called phosphorylation. Right? So these channels don't have just a set amount of depolarization that they need to become active, to open. They can become more sensitive to a small depolarization by activating signaling pathways that cause the channels to be phosphorylated. So when they're phosphorylated, they start to mimic what's happening with these mutations. Of course, with the mutations, they're like this all the time. It doesn't have any way to shut it off. But when they're phosphorylated, you would imagine, you know, there's like an inflammatory mediator or something like that. And then that ultimately changes the way that the cell performs. So one thing we're going to try to work through next week when we talk about mediators and how they work is how that kind of those signaling events happen in nociceptors to go from a certain type of receptor to a voltage-gated channel, a voltage-gated sodium channel in the fibula. All right, so NaV1.8 is very well known for being very specific for nociceptors. It's also very well known for being TTX resistant. But it also seems to play a really important role in neuropathic pain. So remember I showed you with nerve injury, NaV1.3 expression is turned back on, right? NaV1.8 is not turned on and turned off. But what happens is that if you have a nerve injury, NaV1.8 protein is trafficked to the site of injury. So this is showing that here. So this is a non-injured, this is an injured nerve, and the red is the NaV1.8. And you can see that it increases pretty dramatically. And it's essentially accumulating at the site where you have the injury. And if you have more of this channel, it increases the excitability at that site. Okay. So what the next slide shows is that that has a big impact on C fibers. So these C fibers become more excitable, and they also have a noticeably larger amount of TTX-resistant sodium channel current. So in A, this is just showing you the compound action potential. B is looking only at the A fibers and whether or not there's a change in the TTX-resistant currents after injury. And you can see, so here's the sham surgery. So it's a surgery without actually injuring the nerve. This one is an injury, it has a surgery plus you injure the nerve. There's no change in A fibers, as you would expect, because A fibers don't really express these channels anyway, right? But if you look at the C fibers, the amount of the TTX-resistant current goes up pretty dramatically, right? So in addition to NaV1.8 being found in this specific subtype of neuron, it also seems to play a role in the injury response, and this has made it a really important target, in particular for neuropathic pain. So the issue with NaV1.8 has been the same that it's been with NaV1.7. It's been very hard to develop specific drugs that target it, but the situation now is the same that it is for NaV1.7. There are companies that have finally been successful in doing this, and these drugs are now starting to enter clinical trials, and it's getting its day in court. So we're also going to see if these can be effective for treating pain. So the final one that we'll talk about today is NaV1.9. So about 10 years ago was kind of the heyday for discovery of mutations in NaV1.7, and now NaV1.9 is really the hot gene that geneticists are looking at for mutations that cause changes in pain sensitivity. So basically what has been found is that there are some mutations in NaV1.9 that cause episodic pain disorders that appear to occur without any injury. They're somewhat similar to what you see with NaV1.7, but the NaV1.7 gain-of-function mutations seem to cause a much more persistent type of pain than do the NaV1.9. What is the factor that causes them to be episodic? I don't think anybody really knows, but you know, people are actively trying to figure that out. There are some other ones that cause peripheral neuropathies that are painful. These also look kind of similar to what you see with NaV1.7. And then finally, there are some mutations that cause a complete inability to experience pain, many with self-mutilation. For reasons that are also not very well understood. The issue with this is that with NaV1.7, it's really clear cut. Okay, if you take the mutation, you go to a cell and you ask, is it a gain of function or a loss of function? I'm not aware of a single example where they found that it's a gain of function and the person has an insensitivity to pain. It's always the opposite. If it has a loss of function, they don't have pain. If it's a gain of function, they have pain all the time, although it's often in a specific part of their body, as we talked about. Okay? With NaV1.9, there's no really clear pattern. There are some mutations where people have congenital insensitivity to pain, and you go and record the channel activity, and the channel activity is actually increased. Why? I don't think anybody has any idea. And you know, there are lots of people that are actively trying to figure this out. One of the issues with this is, you know, these are experiments, right, that people have to do. And it turns out that expressing these channels in cells is not the easiest thing to do, and NAV1.9 is the hardest one to express in cells. So you can express NAV1.7 and NAV1.8 in cells and relatively easily get currents. With NAV1.9, that's a really, really hard thing to do. And that's another thing that, as far as I know, nobody knows exactly what the reason for that is. But it really hinders the ability to make discoveries to figure out why these things are happening, because it's just hard to get the experiments up and running in the first place, because it's so hard to express the channels in cells. Okay? So there's no really clear picture here, but this hasn't stopped academics and companies from trying to find NAV1.9 targeting drugs, but it's way behind where we are with NAV1.7 and NAV1.8. Okay? So this one is definitely not getting its day in court, but lots of people are thinking about the litigation. And this just kind of summarizes where we found mutations. There are some gain of function, painful phenotypes, but also importantly, gain of function, painless phenotypes. And like I said, this is just something that has not been the case with NAV1.7. Okay? If you have a gain of function, it causes a pain phenotype, not a painless phenotype. And then a lot of them are just not characterized, again, for these kind of experimental reasons that I was talking about. One of the really interesting things about NAV1.9, though, is that it also changes its sensitivity very readily. Okay, so this is showing you an experiment where cells are essentially exposed to something that activates all the G-protein coupled receptors in those cells. And you can see that the number of action potentials is increased pretty dramatically, and that's mostly driven by NAV1.9 currents. So these types of voltage-gated sodium channels, NAV1.7, NAV1.8, and NAV1.9, can all be modified by post-translational modifications that change their excitability. Okay. So what this means, probably, is that injury can also drive changes in the functionality of these voltage-gated sodium channels, and that's really important for the excitability of these cells. So that plays a key role in what we call sensitization, which will be the entire focus of the third part of this course. So we'll wrap up today talking briefly about potassium channels. Any questions on sodium channels though, before we move on?
Yeah.
So let me answer the first question first. So the first question was, what's the difference between NAV1.7 and NAV1.9? So there's two key differences. NAV1.7 has less specificity for the DRG than does NAV1.9. So NAV1.7 is found in the sympathetic nervous system. It's also found in some brain areas. It's additionally found in the smell system. So mice that don't have NAV1.7 have really severe pain deficits. They also can't smell. So for a long time, people knew that NAV1.7 played some kind of role in survival, because mice with mutations in NAV1.7 didn't survive very long. And then somebody finally figured out it was because they basically couldn't smell their mother's milk. So they weren't getting the signal to start feeding. And once they figured that out, they could get the animals feeding, they could help them survive. So blocking NAV1.7, while it may well work for pain, may also make it so that you can't smell anything. So that's one side effect consideration for NAV1.7. NAV1.9 is pretty specific for the DRG, and in particular for small diameter neurons. Another big difference between them is their pharmacology. So NAV1.7 is not blocked by TTX, but NAV1.9 is blocked by TTX. So we have a much better handle on NAV1.7 pharmacology in general than we do for NAV1.9, but there's that obvious very clear distinction. So NAV1.8 and NAV1.9 are both TTX resistant. Your second question was, do people that have NAV1.9 mutations have episodic pain, also have episodic painless? That's an awesome question. I have no idea. I mean, you would imagine, based on the kind of lack of clarity with the function matching phenotype, that could be possible. But I don't know. I mean, I don't know. That's a great question. I'm very curious about. I haven't seen anybody report that. It may be possible there's a new paper that has described that. But, you know, theoretically, yeah, it should be probably the case, right? But I don't know. Great question. Anything else? Okay. Andy. So he didn't do it with brain because he thought that there might be some amount of expression of these TTX resistant currents in the brain, and that he would subtract them out just because there was a small amount. It turns out, you know, he'll tell you the story if you ever ask him, and it's a great story. They wanted to get two things out of this screen. What time is it? Do I have time for a short aside? Yeah. Okay, so they wanted to get two things out of this. One thing that they wanted to get out of it was the TTX-resistant sodium channel, which they got. And the other thing was the capsaicin receptor, TRPV1, which they did not get. And the reason they didn't get it now, he knows, everybody knows, is because there is a little bit of TRPV1 expression in the kidney. And he never would have guessed that the kidney has a mild capsaicin sensitivity. Because there's no functional way to really look at that, right? But it does, and he didn't get it because of that. If he would have also gotten the TRPV1 receptor, you know, he would really be a famous guy. He's already a pretty famous guy, but you know, that really would have been something else. But he didn't get it because he chose the wrong tissue. If he would have chosen liver, which you mentioned, there's no TRPV1 expression in liver. He probably would have got it. So, you know, it's just an accident of history. He chose the wrong tissue for the subtractive method. Okay, anything else? Potassium channels. So, potassium channels, again, there are so many of them, and they can form so many different options because one protein does not, or sorry, one mRNA does not lead to one functional channel. Remember, you have to have at least oligomer, and it's usually a hetero oligomer, so it's multiple different subunits coming together to form a channel. So they're very complex, right? So we just don't know as much about them because they're more difficult to study, but a very clear theme is kind of emerging in the field, which I'll talk about in the next couple of slides. So that theme is that when you have a nerve injury, there are big changes in expression, okay? So we talked about one example of that already. It's NAV1.3, right? NAV1.3 is essentially not expressed in the adult nervous system. You have a nerve injury, it turns back on. So that's an example of going from no expression to some expression or a high level of expression. There are other examples where you have a high level of expression and then you have an injury and you basically turn off the expression. And that is what happens for potassium channels. Right, so if you just think about the excitability of neurons, right? If you get more sodium current, do you increase or decrease the excitability? Increase. All right, good. If you get less potassium current, do you increase or decrease excitability?
Increase.
Less. Exactly. You increase, right? So what seems to happen in DRG neurons as a result of injury is you increase the sodium current and you decrease the potassium current. Both of those things lead to an increase in excitability, and the apparent cumulative effect is like a double whammy, right? You get a really big increase in excitability. So we now understand that there's a broad variety of Volskii potassium channels that are their expression is shut off by nerve injury. So the one I'm going to talk to you about in some detail is in this slide, and that's KD9.1. So this one is interesting because it's not actually even a voltage-gated sodium channel. It's actually a accessory subunit to voltage-gated potassium channels that helps to traffic them to the membrane. Okay, so this is like a helper to voltage-gated potassium channels to get more of them into the membrane. So Steve McMahon's lab published this paper a couple of years ago, and essentially what they showed over here is that if you look at sham versus injured for KV9.1 expression, you see that in the sham, or in the normal case, you have a lot of KV9.1 expression, but it's essentially completely gone in the injured DRG. So it's the exact opposite of NAV1.3. Okay? It's expressed, and then you shut it off. So what are the consequences of shutting this off? And shutting it up, the shutoff lasts for a very long time, right? It's up to 28 days after the nerve injury. It turns on relatively quickly. Within 3 days, it's essentially gone, and this lasts at least as long as they look in the experiment. So what's the consequences of just blocking expression of KV9.1? That's what this shows over here. All right. So here's the control. They didn't do anything to KV9.1 expression. Over here is the siRNA. So first of all, what's an siRNA? This is what siRNA means, is small interfering RNA. And basically, it's a RNA molecule that interferes with the stability of the KV9.1 mRNA and either causes it to be degraded or blocks its translation, okay? So it's an experimental tool that you can use to, without doing a nerve injury, reduce KV9.1 expression. So the purpose of the experiment is basically to recapitulate this, all right? Turn on the expression. So what do you see here? Well, they're just stimulating the neurons at different frequencies, so 5 hertz, 10 hertz, 20 hertz, and then just recording from them, okay? So you see in the control situation, if you stimulate the neuron fires an action potential, but that's it, okay? There's no after discharges, there's nothing. It's just, it follows the frequency at which you stimulate it, okay? In this case, we've lost KV9.1, we're causing the neuron to fire at 5 hertz, and notice what happens. The neuron fires the action potentials, it follows the frequency, but it starts to fire extra action potentials, okay? So basically, its excitability has gone up. And if you make the neuron fire more action potentials, the excitability goes up even more, okay? So basically, it's amplifying the signal and leading to this generation of what we often call after discharges. Okay, so it's continuing to fire action potentials. The other thing that's really important is not only does this happen, but if you just record from the neuron over a long period of time, it will fire action potentials by itself. Okay, it turns out that this here is really kind of the hallmark of neuropathic pain. We call this ectopic activity. And again, if you just go back to one of the things we talked about the first day of class, if you're just sitting there in your chair, you don't want your C fibers to be firing, right? That's sending a pain signal. None of us want to have a pain signal when we're sitting in our chair, or when we're walking, for that matter. But if these neurons are just firing action potentials all the time without any stimulation, you know, that's causing pain in the absence of stimulation, which, number one, that's a hallmark of neuropathic pain, okay? So people just have burning or shooting, more often shooting or stinging pain without any stimulus. And if you go in and do microneurography and record from their peripheral nerves, you can see that they can have ectopic activity. And now we're producing ectopic activity simply by reducing the expression of this accessory subunit to voltage-gated potassium channels. So how could we use this therapeutically? Well, you would imagine you'd want to know what causes its downregulation. So this is an area where people are very actively working to understand that and potentially reverse this downregulation. So turn the transcription factors or whatever it is that is suppressing this off, or turn them back on, right? Depending on which direction it's going. There's no solution to that problem yet. Okay, so I want to wrap up today by taking all this back and talking about clinical finding, all right? So I'm going to tell you just quickly about two papers that were published in 2014 that I think are really important. So the idea of these works was to find neuropathic pain patients and try, as hard as they could, the neurologists and the anesthesiologists, to figure out what nerve the pain was coming from. And then they did an incredibly simple experiment. They just stuck a needle into the nerve, as close as they could get to it, and injected lidocaine. And they asked, in what proportion of patients did the pain go away? So there are competing ideas in the pain field of whether or not, you know, chronic neuropathic pain is driven by what many of us refer to as ectopic activity in the peripheral nervous system, or whether it's something that emerges from what we sometimes refer to as central sensitization, or whether the pain was centralized. Okay? So if you subscribe to the idea that you need a peripheral driver for pain, you would hypothesize in this experiment, if they could figure out what nerve was active, that in probably 100% of the patients, you would be able to make the pain go away. It wouldn't be permanent, but at least when you block the peripheral input, the pain would go away. Okay? All right, so what did they find? So this is showing you the data from one of the papers. Here they did nerve block versus IV lidocaine, where they can only inject a little bit, and that will get into the brain, whereas this won't get into the brain. What you see is that the number of patients that got pain relief from the nerve block, once they found what nerve it was coming from, is 100%. Okay? With the IV lidocaine, they get you about the same concentration of plasma lidocaine as you get here. You hardly get any effect at all. Right? So this is pretty good evidence that if you block the peripheral input, the pain will go away. That does not mean that central sensitization is meaningless. Okay? It could well be amplifying the pain, but it does demonstrate, at least in this cohort of patients, that the pain does require a peripheral driver. Okay, there has to be some kind of signal from the peripheral nervous system to make this work. This is basically showing the same thing. So I want to just wrap up by trying to tie those two things together, right? I think have pretty good data that for the majority of neuropathic pain patients, there needs to be some kind of peripheral driver. That peripheral driver is probably coming from nociceptors, but we can't give these people a nerve block all the time, right? There are side effects that may well, over the long term, make the neuropathy worse, and it's going to block motor function and do other things that those patients are not going to want to do. So what is the best solution to the problem? I would argue that at least one of the potential best solutions to the problem is to specifically block the nociceptors. And the way to do that is by going after these voltage-gated sodium channels, like NAD1.7 and NAD1.8, because they are specifically expressed by those cells. They're mostly not found in other places, and blocking them probably is not going to cause some form of neuropathy, and it's certainly not going to cause the detrimental motor effects or stopping the heart if you get the dose wrong, you know, than you would get from some of these other things, okay? So again, this is not something that has made it from the point of concept to a clinical drug, but it's getting dangerously close to being tested, and you know, I think we'll probably get an answer to it within the next couple of years, which is gonna be pretty exciting for the field, okay? All right, so I think that is all I have to say for today. I think that's the last slide. You guys have any questions before we adjourn? Okay, everybody have a great weekend. We'll see you next week. It is Thursday, right? Yeah. All right, good.